नमस्कार। टुडे वी विल डिस्कस द एंडिंग ऑफ द प्ले पिग्मैलियन बाय जॉर्ज बर्नार्ड शॉ। बट बिफोर दैट लेट मी आस्क यू अ सिंपल क्वेश्चन। हाउ डू वी रीड अ प्ले? हाउ डू वी वॉच अ प्ले? अ प्ले और एनी अदर स्टोरी इंट्रोड्यूसेस अस टू अ नंबर ऑफ कैरेक्टर्स दैट वी हैव नेवर एक्चुअली सीन इन अ रियल लाइफ। अ स्टोरी इंट्रोड्यूसेस अस टू अ नंबर ऑफ इवेंट्स दैट हैव नेवर एक्चुअली हैपेंड इन अ रियल लाइफ। You may say that you know some of the historical incidents that happened, which are the quintessence of the play that you are watching. But even if Julius Caesar were to watch the play Julius Caesar by William Shakespeare, he would find that the character Julius Caesar is very, very different from the historical person Julius Caesar himself. A story introduces us to a fictional version of perhaps the real life characters that are there in our society. But over the course of our engagement in the story, in any form, we identify with the characters. Rather, we become the characters. That's why when we are watching a horror movie and a gust of wind passes through the ear of, let's say, the protagonist, then we become afraid because we think that the ghost is chasing us. And not only that, we become involved so much in the incidents of the story that we expect some kind of a resolution to the conflict that we have seen unfolding in the play. If there is no conflict, then there is no play. Why do we expect that kind of an end? Now, let me give you one example. Suppose you are a cricket fan like me and you are watching a match between India and any other country, and in the last over, in the last ball, only 6 runs are required for India to win the match, and Dhoni comes to bat and the bowler is about to ball, he starts his run up, and then you are all excited, okay? You are biting your nail with your teeth, sitting on the edge of your seat to see what will happen, and on that moment suddenly there is a blackout, the electricity goes away. Won't you feel frustrated? Now, why will you feel frustrated? It is not only the journey that you enjoy, but also the end. You, in case somebody told you that, okay, India finally won the match, but that itself will not be satisfaction for you because you want to experience the ending by being there. What is this obsession of we as readers, as spectators, as viewers with an ending of an artwork? We as human beings do not have an end in our own life. You may say that death may be an end in our life, but it is not. We are not there to experience what happens to this character that we have fallen in love with, that is ourselves, after death. Somebody else will perhaps evaluate us. For them, our life may be an artwork, but for us, we don't know what will happen to us. So we live our life as a sense of, in a sense of continuum, as something unending. So perhaps the lack of ending in our life makes us desire a kind of definitive end in the stories that we read. It is something that gives us what Aristotle would call catharsis or purgation. You know, this feeling of watching a play well made, watching an artwork complete, the sense of completeness we find in the story. But what if a work of art, a play, a movie does not give us that sense of ending to us? What if we do not know what will happen to the character at the end of the play? What if they don't live happily ever after, as is the case in many of the happy ending movies? Now see, we do not necessarily want a happy ending or a sad ending. In case a play ends happily, we call it comedy. In case it ends sadly, we call it tragedy. It's a definition in the rule of a thumb. Of course, there are, you know, plenty of complexities here, but then we still want some kind of a resolution in the story. The play Pygmalion by George Bernard Shaw does not give us an ending. So what happens in this play Pygmalion? A young girl named Eliza Doolittle, who is selling flower near Covent Garden, once meets a phonetics professor named Professor Henry Higgins. And one thing leads to another. She ends up being coached by the professor how to speak proper English. She is an English girl, but she learns how to speak sophisticated English, the English that is accepted in the 20th century sophisticated society in London. Over the course of 6 months, Henry Higgins, his friend Colonel Pickering, who has recently returned from India, who is also a linguist, having written a treatise on Sanskrit, train her in the manners of a duchess, how to behave like a duchess. They take, for example, midterm examinations, right? Higgins takes Eliza to a party hosted by his mother to see how she performs. They take end-term examination at the end of the 6 months, like your examinations, where Eliza is introduced to an ambassador's party as a duchess, and nobody notices that she was a common flower girl. She speaks English so fluently in the sophisticated manner, the Queen's English. She behaves so politely that everybody thinks of her as a duchess. Henry Higgins, Colonel Pickering, and Eliza Doolittle return from the party successful. And on the same night, Eliza does something that is beyond the comprehension of Higgins. What she does is, she throws the pair of slippers that Henry Higgins had demanded of her. And we are as perplexed as Higgins was. Hey, I taught you for about 6 months and this is how you are paying me? I made you a duchess, you were a gutter snipe, and this is how you are expressing your gratitude to me? Now, why does Eliza throw the slippers at Henry Higgins? To know that, let us understand, why does anybody throw slippers or footwear at other people? Now, you may have seen that many political authorities have been thrown slippers at, boots, sandals, etc. Now, why do people do that? Throwing slippers is a kind of symbolic action of undermining the authority of a person who is in authority. When somebody throws a footwear at somebody, then that person is saying that, hey, I don't think that you are my leader and I am disobeying you openly. I do not consider you as my boss. Eliza was doing just that. Having spent 6 months in the house of Higgins, having learned everything that Higgins had to teach her, having actually mastered the art of public speaking, the art of behaving properly in the sophisticated manner, she realizes that she now requires independence and she cannot be bullied by Henry Higgins. She leaves the house of Higgins the very night. The next day, Higgins and Colonel Pickering meet her in the house of Mrs. Higgins, who is the mother of Henry Higgins. And there, in a long dialogue between Higgins and Eliza, we see a kind of existential crisis that Eliza has been through by leaving the self of a flower girl behind by acquiring a kind of qualification for which she has no proper application. Eliza asks Higgins, why did you pick me up? Why didn't you leave me in the gutter? Why did you change me? What's to become of me now? Now that I have learned this language, I cannot unlearn this. I cannot go back to the gutter. I cannot start selling flowers again. Higgins tells her that you could get married to somebody. Then Elijah says that I was better than that earlier. I was selling flowers, but I was not selling myself. In case I do get married, then I will be somebody else's subordinate. I do not want that. Eliza feels the same kind of existential crisis, perhaps a little different though, that Jimmy Potter finds in a famous play called Look Back in Anger by John Osborne. Now, what was the problem of Jimmy Potter? Jimmy Potter was graduated from a white tile university and he had absolutely no prospect of getting a white collar job. Now, what will you do with a kind of qualification that makes you at least superior in a surface level sense to others, but does not give you a profession? What if somebody possessing the qualification of doing extremely different algorithms on computer does not find a job that suits his qualification? Can he go back to his ancestral profession, let's say, of plowing the fields? Now, this is the crisis that Eliza is in. And she has one choice, two choices actually. Either to go back to the house of Higgins, continue to stay with them. She does not know what will be the reason, what will be the result of her stay there, or to find a life for herself. Professor Higgins tries to convince her, tries to persuade her that you come back to my house, and she does not relent. She does not want to come back to the house of Higgins and wants to pursue her life on her own. Now, at the end of the play, Eliza effectively dismisses the offer of Henry and does not go back to his house. This is what happens in the original version of the play written by George Bernard Shaw in 1912. Now, this particular ending was perplexing for many audience because, you know, they expected that the hero and the heroine should get together. Now, when we watch a series, for example, let's say the American TV series Friends, didn't we want the protagonists to get together? And perhaps, unlike a work of art like a novel and a short story, a play gives the audience the ability of predicting and rather altering the ending that the author had given them. The audience wanted Eliza to go back to Professor Higgins so much that in the subsequent editions of the play, the directors changed the ending to suit the requirement of the audience. Eliza does in fact come back to the house of Higgins in the subsequent editions of the play, and George Bernard Shaw was not at all happy about it. G.B. Shaw was so disgusted by this alternative ending to the play that he wrote a postscript titled What Happened Afterwards, in which he justifies the decision of Eliza Doolittle to move away from Henry Higgins. He says that the decision of Eliza to go away from Henry was not a romantic but a commercial one, but an economic one. When a woman gets the affection of an old bachelor like Henry Higgins, then she decides based on her current situation. Eliza Doolittle was a young girl with plenty of prospects. Will she become a subordinate person of Henry Higgins or try to find somebody that she could really be a match for? And that is why in a postscript, Shaw predicts that Eliza Doolittle will marry Freddy, who is a young romantic fool sort of person, but adores Eliza like anything. But then that was G.B. Shaw. Of course, a number of productions did not agree with that kind of an idea, and they changed the ending to suit their particular audiences. In the movie versions of the play, the 1938 version titled Pygmalion, the British movie, also Eliza comes back to the House of Higgins. In the musical editions of the play, the Hollywood movie edition of the play, and in the Gujarati, Bengali and Hindi versions of the play, there are again, you know, different interpretations of the play. A play provides the directors and the actors the ability to interpret the play in a brand new manner than conceived by the author himself. In a way, we could see that the relationship between Henry Higgins, the professor who taught Elijah how to speak properly, and Eliza is symbolic of the relationship between George Bernard Shaw and his play Pygmalion. Bernard Shaw, as an artist, wanted his work of art Pygmalion to be performed in a certain way, but he could not control his work of art once he has created. His work of art was translated into several languages, was interpreted by different people in different manner. It was given a kind of different ending that he would loathe to see himself. Now, we could see this play from a number of contexts. Now, let us try to read this text from a post-colonial point of view. Now, in case we study this text from a post-colonial angle, then you would see that the relationship between Professor Higgins and Eliza Doolittle is the relationship between a colonizing master and the colonized slave or the colonized colonies. Now, the master is driven by some kind of a white man's burden to teach what the master thinks is appropriate for the colonized subject to learn. They create a sense of lack. Now, Higgins convinces Eliza to learn how to speak proper English. Eliza was an English girl. Why does he need to teach her how to speak English? Now see, he created this impression that Eliza Doolittle, a common flower girl, is not worthy of the language spoken by Shakespeare, by Milton, the language in which the Holy Bible was translated in the 17th century. Now, the irony is that in the 20th century when this play was written, nobody was speaking like Shakespeare or Milton or in the language of the Holy Bible itself. Do we speak like that? We don't, right? Now, why does he want to convince Eliza that her language was imperfect? It is the same kind of illusion that the colonizing master create when they start invading one particular colony in order to teach them what they think is necessary for them, what they think they lack. In case we see that from the post-colonial angle, then we'll see that Colonel Pickering, a very interesting character in the play, Shivaldra's character in the play, symbolizes the military power as well as the economic enterprise that is behind the colonial oppression. We will also see that Mrs. Pierce, the kind-hearted governess in the house of Professor Higgins, is also symbolic of the evangelical mission that always becomes a part of colonial enterprise. Now, what is the first thing that that Higgins orders Eliza to do when he finally accepts her as a disciple? The first thing he does is order Mrs. Pierce to remove the clothing of Eliza and give her new clothing, right? Except the hat that Eliza was wearing at that time, Eliza does not retain any of her old clothes. Now, this is also the first thing that the colonizing master teaches. The first thing they teach us is how to put on customs, how to adopt new cultures, which are more symbolic of the culture of the Western colonizing masters than the culture of, let's say, the colonized people. That is why when Gandhi decided to decolonize himself, his attire was also a symbol of his decolonization. The clothes that he wore, the dhoti that he wore, showed that he was an Indian and he was not a British person because he was not wearing the British attire. Similarly, Colonel Pickering and Henry Higgins teach her how to speak in the way that will be accepted by people. Of course, we know how Macaulay and many other educationists spread this propaganda, how the colonized subjects must learn the higher culture of the colonizers. And that is why we start learning a different language, thinking that this language is superior to us. But the irony is that once they have learned the language, they cannot go back to the old state. But what they can do is dissociate themselves from the colonizing masters. And that is exactly what Eliza does. Eliza is there for the 20th century Caliban. You remember Caliban, a famous character in Shakespeare's play The Tempest, who says that I learned your language so that I could curse you. So similarly, Eliza Doolittle also, having learned the language, is challenging Higgins, and she says that I would rather teach phonetics to other people and become an assistant of one of her disciples who is also a linguist. And that is where Higgins is hurt. So that is how you see that this play can be a beautiful metaphor of understanding colonialism. We can also study this play from a feminist point of view. The relationship between Higgins and Eliza, needless to say, is the relationship between a patriarchal man and a woman. The decision of Eliza to leave the house in the middle of the night also resembles the action of Nora Helmer in the play A Doll's House by Henrik Ibsen, of whom G.B. Shaw was a great fan, right? And when Nora Helmer in that play A Doll's House leaves the house of her husband, leaving her three children inside the house in the middle of the night, then she decides to find out a personality of her own. When Eliza Doolittle leaves the house of Higgins, she also does that in order to find out a personality of her own. We could study this play from a number of other angles, and it would also help us to know that the title Pygmalion, which is of course the title of the play, also refers to a mythical character called Pygmalion, who was a sculptor himself, who fell in love with a sculpture that he created, Galatea, and he wanted to get married to the sculpture once it came to life. The relationship between Pygmalion and Galatea was a relationship between an artist and the work of art that they produce. And as Galatea will never become the wife of Pygmalion, the author, become the wife of the sculptor, similarly, Eliza Doolittle could never become the wife of Henry Higgins. Similarly, the play Pygmalion could never be confined into the idea of George Bernard Shaw himself. But even after all this discussion, I think it is relevant to mention what one of my students once told me, that despite all these theories about the death of the author, the relationship between an artist and their work of art, feminism, post-colonialism, this play could be simply understood as a love story in which neither Henry Higgins nor Eliza Doolittle have the courage to confess their love to each other. They are both weak and they are hurt by their own ego, because the first person who confesses their love to each other will become the weaker among the two. Both Henry Higgins and Eliza are strong personalities who have a sense of domination of the other, and they will not be satisfied if either of them is dominating the other. Do you think that any other interpretation is possible? Kindly let me know. Now, I will also end this lecture, but just like G.B. Shaw, I will also not give you a sense of an ending. I'll end this lecture with a question to you. At the beginning of the play, there are two characters who are poor. One is Eliza Doolittle, a common flower girl, and her father, Alfred Doolittle, who was a common dustman. Both of them, in some way or the other, meet this Professor Henry Higgins. At the end of the play, Eliza Doolittle has the manners of a lady without the fortune of a lady. She knows how to behave like a lady, but she does not have the money of the lady. And her father, Alfred Doolittle, has become a gentleman. But he has the riches of a gentleman, the fortune of a gentleman, without the manners of a gentleman. How do you think we assess a gentleman or a lady? Is it the riches that they have gathered, or is it the manners that they are capable of behaving in? Now, the answer to that question will also be in the text. So I hope you read the text and enjoy the text.